So can you just say your name, your where you live, and what you do?
I'm Bob Bigwood. I live here in Clinton, Iowa, and I'm retired right now. Do some part-time construction work, part-time delivery work, but theoretically, I'm retired.
And what brings you here today?
I saw a piece of paper 6 months ago or whenever it was about they were doing interviews about the strike in 79, and they were asking for people who would be willing to be interviewed, and I said, why not?
And can you tell us more about what exactly you did at the plant?
The first year I was there about a year, I worked in the refinery. Worked for my dad. I was there exactly 1 year to the day when I got drafted. I spent 2 years in Vietnam, and then I came back and returned to the refinery for a little while, and then in the spring of 70, I got my apprenticeship as a millwright.
Just before we get much farther, I have to read this like little sheet here for the school. You have been selected to speak with us today because you have been identified as someone who has much to share about the subject of the 1979 strike at the Clinton Corn Processing Company. We would like to record our conversation today. We also need you to sign a form devised to meet Augustana Special or Augustana College's research requirements. And two other forms to give the recordings as a gift to the Clinton Public Library. Essentially, this document states that one, only the information that you are comfortable being used in the research will be used. Two, your participation is voluntary and you may stop at any time if you feel uncomfortable. And three, you may choose to remain anonymous if you wish. Otherwise, your name may be used in future presentations, publications, documentaries, and online materials based on this research. Please sign the release forms after reading them if you agree to participate. After the recording has been transcribed and you have placed whatever restrictions you would like on what information will be released, then the materials will be placed in the archives of the Clinton Public Library permanently. Thank you for agreeing to participate. We plan this interview to last no longer than 1 hour. During this period, we have several questions that we would like to cover. We do not foresee that any question will make you uncomfortable, but please let us know if it does, and we can move to another topic. Please also let us know at any point if you need to end the interview earlier, and we will shorten the interview. On the other hand, if time begins to run short, it may be necessary to interrupt you in order to push ahead and complete this line of questioning, or to come back for a follow-up interview.
Okay.
Y'all good with that?
Yeah, that's fine.
So you said that you heard about this on the newspaper, from the newspaper like 6 months ago. What like was it that, I mean, that was a while ago. Like, why is it so important to you for you to come here? Like I don't remember what I would have read 6 months ago in the newspaper. Like, what exactly brings you here today? Or what do you want people to know about the strike?
I guess that you people wanted to do interviews about how people in city, people in Clinton and everybody around it reacted and how it affected them. Kind of figured I fit right into those categories in several different areas. You know, it kind of depends on what questions you ask, which way it goes. You could get a lot of information, no information. Kind of up to you. But like I said, I called a couple different times and we just had trouble getting interview time set up, and then quite frankly I forgot about it. I still had his number in my phone, and when he called I knew who it was, so. And today I just happened to be available.
So, like, tell me about before the strike happened, like, how were things going at the plant for you?
Oh, things were good. I mean, it was basically anybody that had people that worked there just plan on going there and working and ending your life there. You know, I had already I had been married, you know, first, and chance to go to work, you know, and after you're married you just figure, okay, that's what you're gonna do. I first started, everybody went to the extra board, and you kind of bounced around, but I was pretty sure I wanted to go to the refinery because that's where most of my relatives were. And it was a good place to advance. It was steady work. Basically, it was just the idea that everybody else worked there, I worked there. And that's kind of how it happened.
How do you think the general climate was in the average worker towards...
Tense. It was tense. Well, the first 5 years, 6 years, 7 years, I don't think it was tense. Everything kind of went along because everybody got along. It was still standard brands. It was still, you know, Clisby. I think Clisby was still involved, you know, one of the original people. There was a much happier group. Everybody kind of got along. The supervision didn't have their agenda, and the people in the workforce didn't have their agenda. It was just, it was really a nice place to work, a good place to work. Good benefits, you know, made money.
What'd you do at the point?
At this point? Yeah. When I was in the refinery, I started out right in the bottom dumping new char, which was a powdered black, you know, just the same thing they make tires black with. But that was my first 4 or 5 months I was in the refinery, that was my job. And they used a new char to make a carbon slurry that they used to filtrate syrups and sugars. And as, you know, as you're there, you just progress up the line. You go from there to the pump floor, and then you went to the Olivers, and then once you got there for a while, you got to run some of the specialty systems or the, you know, and each job meant more money. Each job had more responsibilities. It was, you know, the ultimate goal generally was either get a pan job or one of the control room jobs. I mean, that's where you wanted to be.
And so when the strike came along, what role did you play in it?
Sat at the outside looking in. The strike was a ugly thing, and everybody knew it was going to happen. We had just had the last baby, and after all the stuff that happened in 75 and then again in 78, 79 was just and the people in the plant all had agendas, you know. 79, I was no longer in a refiner. I was in skilled trades then, so my perspective was, you know, a whole lot different than the guys that worked at production had a feeling, basically, that they were stuck there forever because that's what they had. They didn't have anything else, you know. It's not really a big demand for somebody to dump bags or load boxcars. It's just not a, you know, the guys that were in the trades, we had more training, we had a little bit more knowledge, you know, we had sort of a chance to succeed on the outside or outside the plant walls. And quite frankly, most of the people in skilled trades were smarter, or not smart, that's not really the right word, were better educated, more informed. People in that were in process were there just to go to work and make money, period. They didn't really think of anything else other than making more money. Whereas we were in a, we had to make it work so they could make money. And, you know, it was just kind of a difference. There's quite a difference between the skilled trades group and the production groups. And it never changed.
How did each of those groups take the strike when it happened?
I don't think any of them took it as a group. I think everybody took it individually more so than... The group thing was kind of a... There were several groups, you know. There was, all I want is more money, all I want is more insurance, all I want is go to work, all I want, you know, it was several different factions all... trying to, you know, looking for a gain, just not really sure what the gain was going to be.
And now looking back at it, like, why does it matter today? I mean, like, obviously everybody here we all know matters today, but like somebody else who's in college, you know, they might think, no, it's just something from the past. Like, what would you tell them?
I don't think students today, you guys today, I don't really think you realize what it was like 40 years ago trying to make a living. Didn't have computers, you didn't have instant access for intelligence, you couldn't ask a question on your telephone to get an answer. And I don't think that when I was working, and you know, my primary concern was trying to make life better for my kids. I mean, when I was there, I mean, things kind of had a bad set of circumstances for me, because I was in college, I got sick, I dropped out on Tuesday, got drafted on Thursday, you know. So you really, really didn't have that. You guys don't have the draft situation. You have awards, but you don't have to worry about being drafted, you know. So, I mean, it was really kind of an ugly situation when you put it in any kind of perspective. But at that time, you know, we weren't making a lot of money, but we were living well. Only thing that was bad about it in 79, when 79 started coming around, the economy was turning to poop, farm industries were falling apart, you know. Farmers were making nothing, like 44 cents a bushel for corn. I mean, it was, the world was separated in a lot of people trying to get ahead and make money, and quite frankly, a union and union shops were a much better place to work and a better place to be involved. I don't think a lot of your businesses and business climates became inclined to monetarily reward people until after all the big strikes happened. You know, the United Auto Worker strikes and the grain miller strikes. I really don't think that the industries in the world started trying to advance until they started trying to make it better not to have a union. That's what I think.
Do you remember anything in particular from, say, like the Labor Day riot? Or the Angela Davis's visit?
I think it was on the picket line. One thing I remember is Starbuck getting his truck shot at and somebody getting pulled out of the front seat and I got a hammer thrown at our car. And yeah, I remember those things, but I don't remember much about it. You know, it was...
You got a hammer thrown at your car? You were inside or not?
No, we were standing there.
Oh.
We were standing at the... if you go over the overpass at Clinton Company and go to the right, there used to be the waste treatment plant, the Rose Garden, that's where we were picketing. And one of the truck drivers decided he didn't want to stand in there. And, you know, it was tense. There was a lot of tension. A lot of things happened that probably shouldn't have happened. But I can't say I ever condoned it, never really said that I was involved in it, but it happened.
Mm-hmm. How do you feel that the union handled the strikes?
Poorly. Very poorly. You go out there and you put your trust in, as a body, you put your trust in this negotiating committee, put your trust in these people that are going to go out there and do the best thing, shake hands with somebody you know who hates you, and then renege on the deal. It's not a good way to do things. It just don't work that way. Real life don't work that way.
Were the instances like, you said the tensions were high and you had the hammer thrown at your car, was that kind of normal or was that not surprising?
Not surprising, but not necessarily normal.
Okay.
I mean, I happened to be with somebody that had a big mouth and was a real pain in the butt. He just agitated people and that's the way it was. I was there because that's the only way I could get my money. You know, I had no really desire to be on a picket line at 2 o'clock in the morning, or wasn't my idea of a good time.
How do you think media coverage influenced public opinion of the whole strike situation?
I think they were pro-labor then, or pro-business then. Everything that happened, they blamed on us. basically, all the outlets, the newspapers. Of course, same people that control Clinton Company control the newspapers, so kind of stands to reason. But I didn't really think that us as laborers got much of a fair shake.
When it came to the police, how do you feel they handled the strike, if you remember?
I think they did what they had to do. I'm not really sure that I'd say that they were overly zealous against us, but I don't think they were overly zealous in trying to help us either. I mean, they had a job to do, and there again, it was, Clinton, if you've been in Clinton and you've been in Clinton long enough, you realize there's a very small group of controlling people. And those controlling people basically controlled everything that happened. Sheriff's Department, Police Department, City Council, who comes into town, who goes out of town. Why do you think there's no businesses in Clinton? You know, the old money didn't want new money coming in. And I felt that way then, I probably still feel that way now. I haven't really changed my mind too much about it.
So you say there's no businesses coming in. Do you think that how the company handled the strike situation influenced how Clinton is today?
The state of Iowa has influenced that, but yeah. There are lots of places to work in town. You know, none of them, you don't make any money. You know, you can go some places and make $35 an hour, or you can go some places here and make $8 an hour. But Iowa, with some of the laws that they have, the state laws, the legislative enactment, I really and truly think that this is a very poor climate for common people. If you're a farmer, you can make it in Iowa, that's me. But I'm not really sure that, I mean, you've got Alcoa in Davenport, and you've got John Deere works down there, but they're not really getting bigger. Alcoa's getting bigger, but most of Alcoa, I really think, is controlled by outside Russia, and Russia's got all the bauxite. But I really don't think that Iowa and the right to work laws are ever in workers' favors. I just don't think that's a, and you can see if you read the papers now, you can see how much of an issue it is in Illinois. You know, every city, every municipality, the governor, they all have this agenda, and you can call it anything you want, but it's an agenda to break it. They want police unions, fire unions, teachers unions, they want them all out. And I think eventually it's gonna happen. But I just don't think you see the unions anymore being able to organize and organize strong enough and organized enough to really make a long-lasting impact. Violence is probably not going to be tolerated anymore. Not the violence it took years ago.
And once the whole strike played out, where did you go to work after that?
Oh, geez. I was in Atoma for a while. I was in St. Paul, Minnesota for a while.
Doing similar work that like you did here, or?
For the first year, I couldn't find a job anywhere. Literally could not find a job. There was nothing here. Anybody that was here that was hiring, as soon as you said you were from Clinton Company, you were basically outlawed. You could not get a job. I couldn't get a job.
You couldn't get a job because they knew that you were involved with the strike? How did you just kind of have to wait for that to, or just keep on trying, wait for that to wear out? Or how did that work?
You know, I quit working here in 79, and I didn't get a job in the area again for 7 years. You know, a job. I worked lots of places, did lots of things, but I couldn't get a job. Not a job to support five kids. You know, house payments and everything else. But you could get work if you wanted to work. Minimum wage jobs, delivering mail, you know, unloading trucks. My wife worked four jobs. It's just the way it was. You know, 3M hired people like crazy, but for the first